Clark, 24 footer, nothing but the bottom of the net. Derek Clark from 24 feet out. And friends, it's a one-point game. 72-71 with a minute three to go.
This is the guy that didn't play much in the first meeting.
McDowell, baseline layup, Johnny McDowell. 74-71, 52 seconds to go. Berentine around the three-point stripe. Gives to St. Julian, over to Wallace, to Clark on the run. Stops, almost slid his pivot foot. 40 seconds to go. Clark calls timeout, and we'll keep it here. 39 seconds to go. McDowell with a clutch baseline layup over Michael St. Julian.
Clutch, exactly right. Derek Clark did not play much in the first meeting. Had 12 points, though, but I'll tell you what, he's made a big difference, especially three-point shooting in the second half to get McNeese State. They had pulled to within one. Then Johnny answers right back, and you've got to believe that Derek Clark is going to be the pivotal man here when McNeese State inbounds.
Well, Jim, it's Saturday night, 78-77 over Stephen F. Austin, 67-66 Saturday night over Southwest Texas.
The margin of victories for the Mavericks in Southland Conference play has been pretty lean. I think they've averaged about 5 points in their wins. So when they win, they have to earn them. There's no question about it.
Seconds to go, 74-71, it'll be McNeese ball. Well, Jim, Derek Clark red hot as Ronald Smith is for the Mavericks from three-point range. He has four of McNeese's 9 three-pointers.
And Derek Clark is just so nonchalant about it. He launched that last one from about 22 feet and actually fell to the ground, may have been fouled, could have had a four-point opportunity.
17 three-pointers out of these two teams, an entertaining game this evening from Texas Hall. Inbounds, it comes to Clark. Shoves it over to Wallace. 31 seconds to go. Clark waits for Talley to clear, is fouled, and he hits the three. The worst case scenario just happened. Derek Clark underneath Sean Talley makes the three-pointer and is fouled, and we're tied at 74.
Sean Talley went for the fake, got in the air when that happened as he comes down.
Oh, this is pretty. Derek Clark, and he sticks it from 20. And the Cowboys can take the lead, and they don't miss free throws.
They are perfect tonight from the line, 14-14. And as you said, the most perfect scenario that McNeese State could draw up happened. They had to score on this possession, or they would have forced UTA to win it from the line. They certainly would have fouled it, but now they have a chance to force UTA to take the final shot.
And Sean Talley collects his third foul. You know, 74 all.
And I was wondering maybe why Ronald Smith wasn't in the game to guard Derek Clark, because he is, in my opinion anyway, the best defender that UTA has. Talley had the responsibility. And we talked about a four-point play that Derek Clark had previous to that, or a chance. This time, he has a chance of a four.
Unofficially, well, it is official. Johnny McDowell, 20 points. Ronald Smith, 23. Leonard Wilson, 10. Three leading scorers for the Mavericks. Derek Clark has 22 for McNeese. Okay, the Cowboys are 14 of 14 from the line, and Derek Clark has a chance to give his team a lead of one. 78% foul shooter. Cowboys has a team hitting 71%. And a subsequent timeout called by UTA, but Jim, this game gonna be decided nevertheless at the line. We'll take our final break with 28 seconds to go. The game tied at 74. Back from Texas Hall right after this. at Texas Hall. Derek Clark at the line to try to make it 75-74. It's hoisted up. It is good. And McNeese State by one. 26 seconds to go. Sean Miller, midcourt.
First lead of the game for McNeese State.
Miller, top of the key, stops, shoots over Barentine. It is short and caught underneath by a couple of Cowboys. 15 seconds, and reaching in was Sheldon O'Neill. And it looks pretty good for McNeese. You had McDowell over the top as well, and they'll get McDowell.
It'll be a 1-1, so you've just got to hope that that McNeese, Sean Miller, pulls the trigger with 15 seconds on the game clock. A little off balance as he's moving to his right. O'Neill was there, as was McDowell.
And McDowell tackling Michael St. Julian in a timeout call with 15 seconds to go. And this now, let's see, Miller is 6'2", and Arantina is 6 feet. He certainly had the height advantage and took the shot from, 13 feet out.
Well, Ronald Smith should check back into the game. Brian O'Neill may come into the game. They need as many three-point shooters as possible unless they plan on calling a timeout after the free throws to set the play up. But either way, Ronald Smith is most likely going to get back in here before this game's over with.
Well, Jim, we were broadcasting the game at Southwest Texas. Same situation. The first foul shot is the key.
It is the key, but in this situation, it's a little different story. You definitely want to make the two free throws in this situation. Southwest Texas, you did not want to. There's 15 seconds, plenty of time for UTA to get off a couple of three shots at the basket anyway.
Mavericks have two timeouts remaining. McNeese State down to one. 15 seconds to go. Cowboys at the line with a 1-1 and leading by one. Michael St. Julian will toe the line for McNeese State. A 6'4 senior from Lafayette, Louisiana, averaging 10 a game. And tonight, St. Julian is 1 of 1.
And as expected, Ronald Smith is coming to the scorer's table. Won't check in.
And the Mavericks down to one timeout as they try to ice Michael St. Julian and let Steve Welch and his team huddle up again. Let's see, rebounds tonight. McNeese State 33, UTA 26.
John, if the Mavericks go on and lose this, they're going to look at a couple of things. They're going to look at a 16-point lead when McNeese State was playing very, very poorly and they didn't bury them. They're also going to look at the free throws. They are 12 of 24 from the line. They just make another six of those, and this game's not anywhere in the situation it is. And it's been a problem this year. Let's see if they can dodge yet another bullet in the last seconds.
Well, Steve Welch, since he has dispensed with a sport jacket, is now 4-0 wearing the sweater. 75-74 McNeese. Each team with one timeout left.
He gets beat twice in 1 year by the Mavericks with a last second when he may go off the deep end.
He may apply for another job. It's Smith, McDowell, Wilson, O'Neill, and Talley for the Mavericks. Michael St. Julian at the line. McNeese State 15 of 15 tonight from the stripe. St. Julian hitting 62% on the year. That last foul by Johnny McDowell, his fourth. St. Julian with a 1-1. It's up and it is no good. Chased down by Wilson. Here's Talley, 13 seconds to go. Mavericks down by one. 9 seconds, Talley going baseline, will stop, shoot, misses everything. Long rebound, O'Neill, 3 seconds, 2 seconds, Smith at the buzzer, yes! It's a winner! It is a winner! Another Saturday night buzzer beater, I don't believe it.
And exactly what happened before, Steve Welch just absolutely cannot believe what has just happened to him. Ronald Smith, as we talked about, would be in the game because of that very same thing. Sheldon O'Neill saves it on the wing, dumps it over to Smith, who unloads.
It's a winner, another Saturday night buzzer beater. Inches away with 8:52 left. Lamar. That caps off a 76-yard drive. John Rayburn on a one-yard sneak. And it is 37-26.
Well, he never got into the end zone, but the ball broke the plane, and that's all that counts.
So Lamar with its second consecutive score after punting earlier.
Well, it's one of those kind of games, you know, the team that has the ball last may win it.
Chris Williams to tack on point number 27. And he does with 8:43 to go. We'll take a short break. Our new score, Lake Highlands 37, Lamar 27. Texas Stadium crowd with 8:43 to go. Lamar down by 10.
Do you onside kick here?
I haven't. Well, no.
Okay.
I don't think so.
For Lake Highlands, maybe it's not important that they score if they can take 4 or 5 minutes off the clock.
76 yards and 12 plays.
That's why Eddie Peach gets paid the big bucks and we call the games.
I think Cejudo probably called about 8 consecutive plays when everyone huddled up as not to take as much time as possible. Scooped up at the 15-yard line. Laster goes sideways, still on his feet.
Oh my.
Breaks another tackle to midfield. Laster beginning to pull away to the 10. Touchdown. Kent Laster. Another coast-to-coast job.
That was 85 yards on that one. Gosh, they've scored 2 touchdowns now and haven't even run an offensive play.
Do you onside kick?
Yeah.
Well, that hindsight 20-20 and 85 yards this time. But you should never let him get loose. Kent Laster, total yardage in the second half on kickoff returns 175.
Well, that's the fourth straight time now that they've touched the ball that they've scored here in the second half.
Let's keep an eye on the Lamar kicker, number 3, Quentin Spencer. Well, the old adage, if you can see his number, let him go. If you can't, go ahead and throw the block.
Well, he had a convoy ahead of him down there, too. Nobody was going to catch him. Crenshaw gave an effort, but no way he's going to get through that herd.
43 points against Lamar.
Wow.
Have to check and see who was top 43 in recent years. No one ever in the playoffs, most points ever. 35, Odessa Permian in 1977, and Arlington Heights in 1978. Wildcats going for 2 more. They're 2 for 2. Ackman, 3 for 3. What a gift. 8:28 left in the game. Another kickoff return and another 2-point conversion. Our score now, Lake Highlands 45, Lamar 27. Six of the 7 possessions here in the second half have resulted in touchdowns. Taken, well, juggled, and finally controlled by Robinson, and he'll go down at the 7. No running room for Julius Robinson. 85 yards on the return by Laster.
Well, you can almost feel the air going out of the balloon, can't you? I'll tell you, those kickoffs just absolutely demoralize you.
Well, Lamar has started from the 20, the 24, the 24, and now the 7.
I promise you, after the game, if I go down and ask Mike Zafuto who the kicking coach is, he'll say him.
Now, he won't let him run wind sprints after the game, will he?
Doesn't need to.
Wants everybody to score. Draw play, Davenport. And Michael out to the 14-yard line.
Well, that was a sure tackle that time by Hicks. Davenport would have gotten at least a first down had it not been for that shirt. Wow, this is some ball game.
Of course, Lake Highlands beat Arlington High 54-28 in week 2, and R.L. Turner 50-10 in week 9. Davenport near a first down.
Well, I went back and checked all the way back through 1989, and I didn't see anywhere where anybody was close to this many points scored against Lamar.
Michael Davenport, 30 carries, 193 yards, and 2 scores.
Wow. Well, looks like he's a cinch maybe to go over 200 again tonight. It'll be the third time this year, second week in a row.
1,600-plus yards. And Rayburn will down it. On first and 10?
Yeah, you don't see that with 7:29 to play usually.
Is there a purpose?
Second down.
Something maybe amiss in the Lake Highland defense, but you'd want to take advantage of it.
Well, Rayburn's 10 for 21 now for 132 yards. He had that one interception. That was by Broom in the first half.
Tight end's open, fellas.
Second and 10. Holder is off the line about a yard. Davenport avoids one.
Ooh.
And runs into a man at the 19-yard line.
That was Rayburn, John. Red.
That intentional grounding looks pretty big now, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does with third and 8.
Well, you're almost in four down situation at this point in the game, aren't you? No matter where you are on the field.
Oh, yeah, 6:55 to go. They're 80 yards away. Third and 8. Oliver's covered. The middle's covered. And the sideline will now set up fourth down. So Lamar will punt for the second time in the second half.
Well, he had a couple of guys open that time, but Rayburn just apparently could not see him down there. We could see him pretty easy up here, but he had Nelson over the middle.
And the punt team has come on. Quentin Spitzer will stand at the 6-yard line.
A little surprised by this?
I'm surprised they've got Spitzer punting. It's been Rayburn punting all year, and been a great punter, but Spitzer got some good ones off tonight.
Fielded at the 41-yard line.
No.
Not another one.
No.
Casey Smith. I don't believe it. Casey Smith, and this game is over.
Boy, the special teams certainly are doing the job for Lake Highlands tonight.
They really are. The special teams have ended the game. Casey Smith joins Laster.
59-yard return here. Look at down the left side. He got terrific blocking again. Boy, the blocking by the Wildcats tonight has been phenomenal.
Big plays for Lake Highlands in the second half. It is 51-27.
Mark Hill averages 167, has rolled scores of 240 and 232 with the handicaps. Has a handicap of 29, and he begins with a strike. Consecutive strikes, as it should be in the championship match. Well, for him, in the championship match, he started out strong his two previous games. Has worked himself up the ladder. Fourth in the standings, defeating Mike Pittman and John Rieger. Oh.
And he gets the tap on the 10 pin.
Got the kick of the 10, and Markell starts out with a double. Chris Pirtle, 12 years old, had his high game a couple of weeks ago, a 235.
That's 235 scratch.
Our previous winners the past 2 weeks in the Bantam Prep Girls Division, Kim Graff. Bantam Prep Boys, Daniel Graff. Junior Major Girls, Jackie Archer. And Chris opens in the second. Chris, the 34th entry in this Junior Major Boys Division. There's a difference right now of 31. 43 entries in this division this year. And Pirtle comes back with a strike. And his total an even 100 after three. Keep in mind, there is a 33 difference in the handicaps. Chris is at 62 and Markell's at 29. Lane four, and another strike on that lane.
It's three strikes in a row for Markell.
Starts out with a three-bagger. His total, 89 after three. Four in a row. You know, and Randy, I don't think we've ever seen four consecutive strikes of the junior majors boy, junior major boys in the championship game. That is a first. And Chris leaving the 6-10. Ages 12 through 17 in this division. Chris converts the 6-10. He marks in the fourth. And after four frames, Chris's total at 120. A difference right now of one. Got a chance, and it goes. He buries him. And Chris with two strikes in his last three frames. And here's Mark Hill trying to string together his fifth consecutive strike. Well, I know we've never seen a five-bagger. And Mark Hill Williams, he is perfect after five. Natural games of 211 and 203. In a row. Chris Pirtle, frame six. Is it going to come back? It did. It rode the ridge almost all of the way, and nothing but strikes out of these two. Eight strikes. Out of these two, nine if you throw in the one by Chris in the third.
There's another one.
Mark another one down. And Chris Pirtle riding a three-bagger. His total 190 after seven. Mark Hill heading into this frame with a 179. Seven in a row.
They play Jones straight away. Lauren Krug is now playing at first base for Matt Blank. Krug, a senior, number 14. The windup and the Foster 2-2 pitch. And Jones is gone. Two outs away from the championship. Strikeout number 5 for Guillermo on the year, number 117. And here's senior second baseman Brad Daniels. Daniels, one out of three. And Foster misses outside. Cougars have not been blank this year. Came into this game having won 19 of their last 21, 7-0 in postseason. By Johnson, but foul. Everyone on their feet behind the Martin dugout. And Michael Kendrick is on deck, and he will hit for Derek Neal. Michael Kendrick, a senior. One gone, bottom of the seventh. Foster whips home. This one is fair, fielded by Johnson, and Krug has it for out number two. One out to go. And Foster will face Michael Kendrick. Martin about to go to 34-5, 11-1 in the playoffs. Award presentations. Will interview head coach Terry King after the game. And there is Michael Kendrick telling home plate umpire Bob Lust that he is now in the batting order for Derek Neal. So the notation being made. Well, the caravan of cars that'll head back to Arlington in the morning with a state championship and a lot to talk about. It's never been done before. Foster about to go to 12-1. And the first pitch to Kendrick is swung on and fouled back.
Prior to this season, the most wins by a pitcher ever had been 11 by Carlton Hightower and Todd Van Poppel with 11. And both Guillermo Foster and Matt Blank are bettering that this year. Foster will have his 12th, and Matt Blank got his 13th last night.
Yes, a few records have been set this year for Martin.
Yep.
Two. Guillermo looks out to center field. Nothing and two to Kendrick. Michael Kendrick. Justin Batson hangs down the sign. The windup and Foster's 0-2 pitch. A new baseball champion in the city of Arlington. They wear black and red. They are the Martin Warriors. First ever baseball championship for an Arlington team. In the bottom of the seventh for Abilene Cooper, no runs, no hits, no errors, and none left. Guillermo Foster strikes out six, ends his Martin senior season with a record of 12-1. Abilene Cooper calls it a year at 27-10. We'll take a break and be back with the awards presentation from Dish Falk Field as Martin blanks Cooper 8-0.